Welcome to Peaceworks, and I'm Heather Gallion. In this episode, we're going to hear from Greg Boyd. We asked some people the following question. Are there times when it's okay for a Christian to kill?
In Christianity, we believe in pacifism, which is being peaceful and not bringing harm to any of God's creations. And so if you're living by that, then I don't think it's ever okay for a Christian to kill.
I think there can be times, but that's more taking it to the extreme.
I don't think it's okay for anyone to ever kill. I don't think killing's ever the answer, because you can always solve your problem in another way, and killing is a permanent thing. Like, if you decide later on that you don't want that to happen, you can never redo it, because as soon as you pull the trigger or stab somebody, they're gone forever and you can never take it back. So I think if you have a problem with someone, you should definitely find a peaceful, better way to solve it.
No, it's not, because God always wanted us to act like with forgiveness and like peacefully, and not have any harm, like do any harm to anyone, and to always be loving each other, even your enemies.
I know you want to hear what some other folks had to say.
Evangelicals and Anabaptists certainly have a lot more in common than they do different, and certainly all Christians have more in common than they do different, but on this one area, there's more difference. And you were coming out of more of an evangelical background, but starting to talk like someone who, where your sermons might have been more received, better received in an Anabaptist church.
Oh yeah, definitely.
And so, how did you personally get from the perspective of an evangelical to something that would feel more at home in an Anabaptist
church? It was kind of a long journey. It wasn't like I had an overnight revelation.
Yeah.
But it started, I think, actually when I was in school in the 80s, and I learned a lot about church history, and church history is pretty ugly.
Yeah.
I mean, man, the Crusades and all the stuff that was done in Jesus' name, and slaughtering people, Muslims, other Christians. Yeah. Even the conquering of America, you read some of the accounts, and that was done in God's name. We're advancing. Yeah. And I thought, that cannot be, right. that can't have anything to do with the true Jesus.
Yeah.
And then later on, they started, we had these political movements like the Moral Majority in the late 80s.
Yeah.
And as an evangelical, I felt like I was supposed to be part of that. You know, Jerry Falwell, and you know, that was when they first started this, we're going to take America back for God stuff. Mm-hmm. But I remember just being very uncomfortable with it. Because even when I agreed with some of the political stances they were taking, it just didn't seem like anything Jesus ever did. Yeah. I mean, there's a haughtiness to it, a pride to it, a, you know, we're going to conquer kind of thing, which is what you get throughout church history. We're going to conquer in Jesus' name. Mm. But we conquer not by the cross. We conquer by getting power to rule the world because we're wiser and more righteous than everybody else. Mm. And so that really began to push me in a different direction to like read the Bible a little bit differently. And then throughout the 90s, other events happened where they were just kind of eye-opening. And I got clearer and clearer about, I was able to read the Gospels without the lens of my indoctrination. Hmm. And that's a very refreshing thing to do. Yeah. And you start noticing Jesus said stuff that we don't talk about much. And you know, you start seeing this radical incongruity between maybe the stuff you were taught and the real Jesus. Yeah. And so I began to see more and more that what he was about was not a religion. Hmm. And what he was about was not starting an institution. It was a revolution. It was a movement. Yeah. And he calls that movement the kingdom of God. And that really has been a lifesaver for me, Bruxy, in this way. Because you can get so cynical about religion. And I was getting so cynical about the Christian religion. To the point where, you know, almost always when Christian spokespeople were on television, I wanted to become a Buddhist. Or if there's debates, I almost always agreed with a non-Christian. And if not for the content, then for the style. It just seemed like there was not a love there. And the Lord really helped free me from that by really helping me collapse my own judgments towards religious people because I'm a sinner like they are and I'm not in a position to be judging them. But also by helping me see that the only thing I need to be concerned with is the kingdom. Living the kingdom 24/7 and then advancing the kingdom. And everything else I can let go, including the Christian religion. I believe that the kingdom always looks like Jesus. He incarnated the kingdom. It's got his DNA. He pours his life into us. And when we're surrendered to him, that kingdom DNA starts to flow out of us, and we start to think like Jesus, love like Jesus, serve like Jesus, sacrifice like Jesus. So the kingdom always looks like Jesus, individually and corporately. And so if it doesn't look like Jesus, regardless of what it calls itself, regardless of what it professes, it's not the kingdom. And so I don't need to worry about it. And I think that was part of my internal struggle was I felt like I somehow was part of that team that slaughtered the Muslims and slaughtered all those heretics. And it created incongruity in my head. But I now feel completely free to let that go. That has no more relationship to the kingdom of God than, say, Islam or Taoism or whatever. There's good and bad found in religions, but it's not the kingdom of God. Any more than the Democratic Party, Republican Party, or any socialist system, or the totalitarian system, or communism. There's different forms of the kingdom of the world, but none of them are the kingdom of God, because the kingdom of God always looks like Jesus.
I just want to give you a big kiss right now. Preach it. That's awesome. You've written a couple books that have touched on this. One is Repenting of Religion, you wrote earlier, which has come out in my speaking. For those from the Meeting House who are listening, I channel the spirit of Greg Boyd every so often. Yeah. Repenting of Religion also.
I hope your eyes don't like roll back.
And recently you wrote not only The Myth of a Christian Nation, but then you wrote The Myth of a Christian Religion.
Religion, yes.
As a follow-up, right? And does that capture some of what you're talking about
here? Yeah,
The Myth
of a Christian Religion, which really should have been titled Revolting Beauty. That's the title I wanted, Revolting Beauty. But the publisher wanted to write on the coattail, marketing stuff. So it's called The Myth of the Christian Religion, which is one of the chapters. But the book's much broader than that. And that book really just expresses the thing I just told you about how the kingdom always looks like Jesus. It always has a Calvary flavor to it. Jesus died for the people who crucified him, praying for their forgiveness with his last breath. That sort of love, where you love your enemies rather than try to retaliate on them crush them, the kingdom always looks like that. And it's a revolution. And so I talk about how Throughout that book, I look at Jesus' life, because I think everything has got to be based on Jesus,
yes.
Everything.
Yes.
And just look at how his life, if you understand it in its original milieu, everything he did and everything he taught bucked the system.
Hmm.
We sometimes don't appreciate how radical it was because we're used to it and we don't know much about the first century. But it's kind of like this. If you hear today about an African, a white male offering up his bus seat to an African American or African lady,
yeah.
You wouldn't think much of it. That's nice, but it wouldn't be that big.
Yeah.
But if you heard that happened in Birmingham, Alabama, in 1957, well, that was making a statement.
Right.
And so also Jesus' life, the way he lived, it was making statements all over the place.
Context is key,
right.
For then seeing how radical some of
exactly.
those things are.
Yes. And so he manifests what it looks like when God reigns in a life. And in the process of doing that, he bucks up against everything in the culture and everything in the world that's inconsistent with that reign of God.
Yeah.
And that's how we push back the kingdom of darkness and advance the kingdom of God.
Wow. Now, and one of the areas where the religious people of his day and Jesus came to complete disagreement on, it seems, is how to respond to those who were aggressing against them, those who were using the way of power.
Yeah.
I mean, the religious people of his day, one of the things he seems to have been challenging them on, if I'm reading him correctly, is not to follow the way of war in order to bring about God's kingdom.
Mm.
And they didn't listen to him and his call of peace,
sure.
And things went poorly for them.
You're right.
So it ties through together both your irreligious message in a sense and the message of peace tie together.
Absolutely.
The way of religion, including the Christian religion, tends towards that reach after power and the
grabbing
use
hold
of power.
Grabbing
hold
of power. Yes. Because power is the way that you control people. And if your motive is to control, even with the sincerest of intentions, it's going to be this kind of power over mindset.
Mm.
And so the most of the leaders of Jesus' day, the Pharisees and Sadducees, they were significantly co-opted by the Roman power.
Mm.
That's what kept them in power. And so Jesus' talk about loving your enemies, as well as a lot of other things that he said, really had a subversive tone to it, which is why they had to put him to death.
Yes.
They had to put him to death.
Yeah.
But yeah, they lacked horns on that one.
And when he taught love for enemies, there was a real enemy who was really aggressing against them for them to love. This was not just a general spiritual ethos, a disposition of
That's
the heart.
That's exactly right.
It was his teaching hit the ground running in a very practical setting.
Right.
And for us to understand that, I think will really help us see that he actually meant, when he said love your enemies, he really meant.
I get this all the time where people say, you know, when I am talking along the lines of loving your enemies.
Yeah.
What I typically get is something like a person will say, well, of course, yeah, love your enemies. But certainly, obviously, Jesus did not mean I'm supposed to love Osama bin Laden or Al-Qaeda or, you know, people who threaten my family or threaten my way of life or threaten my country.
Yeah.
I mean, he doesn't expect us to love that. And in the original context, that's exactly the kind of enemies he's talking about. Because when he says enemies, you know, they may be thinking about the grudge they have with their neighbor or whatever, but the primary thing that first century Jews are thinking of are Romans.
Yeah.
And the analogy would be something like this. Suppose that Al-Qaeda conquered Canada.
Yeah.
And so now, and took away your rights and took away your freedom, and now you're living under this oppressive regime, and they've slaughtered some of your best friends, and okay, you're living under this terrible enemy. That is something like the situation that Jesus was in. Because the Romans were terrorists.
Yeah.
They knew how to terrorize. That's how they controlled. We have accounts from Josephus and other sources of them rounding up innocent people, or these people who their guilt wasn't proven, and crucifying hundreds at one time just to flex their muscle to say, you don't want to mess with us. They were terrorists. And so when Jesus says, love your enemies, do good to those who persecute you, bless those who despitefully use you, they're all thinking, we're supposed to love the Romans, these terrorists who hold us in oppression and
so as Jesus' teaching was leaving his mouth and entering their ears, they were in a context that said, you have to take this seriously and you have to live it practically. Now enough time has passed that we can allegorize it and we can bend it, make it more pliable, try and take the principle and then apply the principle as differently as possible, you know, kind of massage it and stuff it down into our lives now, 2,000 years later, and try and make some different application out of it.
Yeah. or just conveniently ignore it altogether.
I mean, yeah, that's true.
That's easy enough to do. The trouble is we all read the Bible through our cultural lens, and if you're systematically conditioned into the myth of redemptive violence and conditioned to, you know, instinctively regarded as just commonsensical that you use violence when necessary, well, then you just don't see how radical the teaching is.
Yeah.
And so people read it, and they'll think, enemy, okay, well, obviously he means, you know, I'm supposed to love my mother-in-law even though she bugs me. Yeah. But he obviously doesn't mean national enemies.
Yes, yeah.
And so we can really water it down.
We finished up a series recently on the Sermon on the Mount, and in reading through that, looking at the summary comments of a number of evangelical scholars, where Jesus challenges obedience towards the end, building on the right foundation and walking through the narrow gate, and not just saying, Lord, Lord, but those who really will do the will of my Father. And they're summarizing this, and I'm looking at a number of well-known scholars. You would know their names, and they're saying, you know, look at the context of the Sermon on the Mount. What does it mean to do the will of the Father? Well, he's just told us, so let's review that. And as they walk through, they're thinking holiness and righteousness and all wonderful things. I haven't found one yet who have taken the peace teaching of Jesus yet seriously as far as doing the will of the Father. And these are intellectuals and and I mean godly men who are writing these, who I think are wonderful, but it just misses the list. Mm-hmm. It's just kind of skipped over in their review of what it means to follow God.
I think a lot of it, Bruxy, is that that in the evangelical tradition, we have got 1,500 or more years of a tradition of triumphalism. You know, for the first three centuries or so, the early Christians got it. I mean, they were a minority. They were persecuted. They had to be willing to die. You know, they weren't out there trying to, you know, tell Caesar what to do. They're just trying to live out the call of the gospel. And the church spread like wildfire just because of the beauty of the countercultural lives that they lived. Mm-hmm. Well, then, you know, early 4th century, this Emperor Constantine allegedly got a vision that he thought was from God. If he had a vision, I think it was from the devil. But the vision said, if you paint the Cairo, the CR of for Christ on the shields of your soldiers going into this very important battle, I'll give you the victory. First time that Jesus and violence were ever associated that I know of. And so, but this is how pagans think. You know, I want the most powerful God fighting on my behalf.
Right.
So, because then I'll slaughter more of them than they slaughter us.
Manipulative magic.
Right. Exactly.
And he's the new deity in town that seems to be growing in popularity.
Well, somehow Constantine got that in his head. He did it. Painted the Cairo on the shields, and he won. He won this battle. And the next year, he then legalizes Christianity, and Christians start to come into power. He starts throwing money at the church, throwing power at the church. Starts building their nice buildings and all that kind of stuff. Within 70 years or so, it becomes then the official religion of the Roman Empire, which means it's illegal not to be Christian, though they made an exception for Jews. And the year after that happened, we find the first example of Christians putting a non-Christian to death, a killing. And now we start acting like the pagans did.
Well, we don't do well at stewarding power.
No, we don't. Yeah. There's something, we weren't meant to pick up the sword. The minute we pick up the sword, you put down the cross.
Yeah.
But see, then what happened, it's just crazy. Because Satan offered Jesus all the kingdom of the world, all the power of the world. Luke chapter 4, 5 through 7. And Jesus said, no, I'm going to get all the kingdoms, but I'm not going to do it that way. Huh. I'm going to do it through the Calvary way, the slung and low, faithful way. So Jesus saw, and the gospel authors see, the temptation to grab hold of power as a temptation of the devil.
Yeah.
Fast forward it to the time of Augustine, and you have people like Augustine and Eusebius and other church fathers saying, oh, God has given us the power to run the world. And St. Augustine said, if God's given us the sword, well, then surely we must use it for his name. And now we're going to try to take over the world. Following the way of the crucified Messiah goes by the wayside. We're soldiers just like the rest of the world. We just are soldiers in Jesus' name. And we have a long tradition of that. So I don't think they're intentionally trying to not notice the passages about loving your enemy or whatever.
Yeah.
It's just that there's a long tradition of indoctrination that keeps them from seeing that. I was there. I never, up until, you know, I think 10, 12 years ago, I never really got how central nonviolence, peace, loving your enemies is to the gospel. Now I think it's the center. I think it's really? The center of it yeah. certainly is the ultimate test case. Because nothing is more contrary to our fallen self than loving your enemies when your life is on the line. And so nothing is more distinctly Christ-like than giving your life for your enemy. It's I think, the ultimate, you know, shibboleth, the ultimate test case.
I have called you son.